Good evening. I am Jessica Abrahams, and it is my pleasure tonight to welcome you all on behalf of the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum to tonight's program, Stolen Legacy, Nazi Theft, and the Quest for Justice. Welcome to those of you in our studio audience and to our viewers at home. During tonight's program, you can please join us in a conversation on both Twitter and Facebook by using hashtag GoldLegacy. As a living memorial to the Holocaust, the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum strives to teach and to apply the lessons of the Holocaust in efforts to make the phrase never again a reality. Tonight's program is proof of the continued search of individuals and families who are trying to make claims and wrestle back artifacts, funds, and ultimately their identities prior to the Holocaust. Dina's book articulates how documents assume the role of witness in a desperate attempt to tether the past to the present and future. Tonight's conversation further explores the dynamics of this role in piecing together Holocaust memory. For many years, I've been a patron and supporter of the museum, and in the past several, I've had an even greater chance to get to know more about the nature of the work the museum does, the people it reaches, and the fascinating ways that the Holocaust intersects with both the evolution and practice of law. This complements perfectly with my involvement with the Washington Lawyers Committee, which I have the honor of co-chairing. The committee was formed to help the museum broaden its outreach to the legal community in DC and to help elevate an awareness of the centrality of the Holocaust history to many key legal issues and concerns today. These connections are not only intellectually fascinating, but many of them also have a direct application to the work those of us do as lawyers. Tonight's program fits well into this context. Frankly, the human dimensions and therefore the legal dimensions of the Holocaust are frankly seemingly endless. It is now my pleasure to introduce Ellen Meltzer, who is the Director of Marketing and Community Outreach for Moment Magazine. Moment is co-presenting tonight's program. So thank you and welcome to Ellen.
Thank you so much. Good evening, everybody, and welcome. I'm speaking on behalf of Nadine Epstein, publisher and editor of Moment Magazine, who is here tonight with a bad case of laryngitis. And I am her poor substitute. But on behalf of Nadine and Moment, we are thrilled to be here this evening to co-present tonight's incredible program, Stolen Legacy, Nazi Theft and the Quest for Justice, which we are very proud to say was written by Moment's amazing senior editor, Dina Gold. For a publication that was co-founded by Elie Wiesel 40 years ago, a dear friend who even today serves on its advisory board, this is a very important project. When Dina, a former hard-hitting investigative reporter for the BBC, arrived at Moment, she was already hard at work on this book about her quest for justice. When she first told us about it, everyone on the staff was completely blown away by her resourcefulness and determination. We provided editorial design and translating assistance for the last stages of the book, a place she could call home, and even worked with Dina to write and publish a standalone story on the subject, which appeared in Moment's 40th anniversary issue in May of last year. It was also called Stolen Legacy, and you can read the story on our website, momentmag.com. It is now my pleasure to turn the program over to tonight's moderator, Leah Wolfson, Senior Program Officer in the Museum's University Programs Department, who will introduce the rest of the evening. Thank you.
Thank you, Ellen, and thank you, Nadine, and thank you to Moment Magazine. I am joined this evening by Dina Gold, former BBC journalist and author of Stolen Legacy, Nazi Theft, and the Quest for Justice at Krausenstrasse 1718 Berlin, and Suzanne Brown Fleming, director of Visiting Scholars Program at the Mandel Center at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum and author of Nazi Persecution and Post-War Repercussions. I'd like to begin by quoting the former director of the museum, Professor Walter Reich, who has said, quote, "The Holocaust, the project of exterminating Europe's Jews, was an immense act of murder, but it was also an immense act of theft. The murder was, of course, the incomparably greater crime. The dead could never be brought back to life." We are here this evening to talk about a part of the Holocaust, not the mass murder, but the greatest organized thieving in history. So, Dina, what I'd like to start with is the really beginning of your story. And from a very young age, your grandmother, Nellie, told you a fairy tale of sorts about a different kind of life she lived while in Germany before the war. And I'd like you to tell us a little bit about your grandmother and her past.
Well, when I was growing up in London, my grandmother, Nellie Wolff, she used to come and visit us, and she would take me out on trips to London, and she used to love to go to the art galleries or the theatre or the museums, and there we are standing, actually, right outside the British Museum. And one of her favorite things to do was to take me to a very fancy patisserie directly opposite Harrods. And she would order coffee and cakes. And then she would sit down and she would reminisce. And she'd tell me stories of her life before the Nazis came to power. And one of the things that she would always say to me is, Dina, when the Berlin Wall comes down and we get our building back, we'll be rich. She firmly believed that the Nazis had stolen a family building. And of course, all these stories, I was a kid growing up, I was entranced by them. I found them fascinating. And I would lap it all up. Now, Nellie had had a very luxurious life. Mm-hmm. She had married a man called Herbert Wolff. He was the son of a man called Victor Wolff. And there is Victor. This man had two sons, Herbert and Fritz. Nellie married the older one, Herbert. And Victor was a very interesting man. He was a tremendously successful businessman. He had inherited from his father the H. Wolff Fur Company, which his father had founded in 1850. And Victor had built this fur company into an international success. He had had buyers going off to Russia and to Canada to buy pelts. He had offices all over the world. This was one of the premier fur companies in Germany. And Victor had been so successful that he'd managed to buy himself a tremendous villa in Wannsee. Now, you can see there, that's the villa with extensive grounds. They had statues in the gardens. You can see what it was like inside. They had wonderful antique furniture. That's a Gobelin tapestry hanging on the wall. This was sumptuous living. And my grandmother, Nellie, had lived there. Now, this villa, actually, it is, in fact, down the road to where the Wannsee Conference was held many years later. But in this villa, they lived very well. They had cooks, they had maids, there were gardeners to tend these grounds. They had a chauffeur who was living on the grounds. They had a top-of-the-range Mercedes, which he drove. And Nellie, who had three children, my mother being the eldest, was determined that her children should be bilingual in English and German. So she would always bring over English nannies to raise the children. And of course, she would reminisce to me, and I would think it was so fascinating, I'd lap it up. And my mother would say, oh, please, you know, don't listen to these stories. Don't look back in life. What's the point? What's the point? But of course, I did.
And you weave some home movies out of a few of those.
Yes. Amazingly, we do have movies from the 1920s. This family obviously had a cine camera. And we can show footage, and I'll tell you who we're going to be looking at. Right. This is in the garden. You can see the house in the background. The little girl with the beret on is my mother, and they're running around. That old lady there, that is Victor's wife, and the other adult is one of the English nannies that they had over. And what they're doing is picking up chocolate eggs and chocolate rabbits, which the maids had hidden around the extensive grounds at Easter. And this is what they're enjoying doing. They're running around looking everywhere for these chocolates. And having a lot of fun. And you can see how large these grounds were. I mean, extensive.
It's quite beautiful footage.
Yes. Well, here is my grandfather, Herbert Wolff, with his three children. And the little girl, the tallest one, that's my mother. And that's her brother and sister. You can see how very good looking Herbert is.
Yeah.
He had film star good looks.
And we've got some lovely film footage of Herbert as well.
Now, Herbert was the handsome playboy of the family. Mm-hmm. He liked the good life. And he particularly liked going sailing. Yeah. Uh-huh. This was a ladies' man. Uh-huh. Look at that, with a twinkle in his eye. Oh, yes, he knew he was good looking. He was a frightful womanizer, I'm afraid. He clearly had great success with the ladies. Look at him there. Mm-hmm. He's got, looks yeah. like Errol Flynn.
Absolutely.
Would you say? Yes.
Absolutely.
Film star. I'm afraid he was never too faithful to poor Nelly. Well, then, of course, Hitler came
so
to power.
So tell us a bit about how the story changes at that point.
Well, when the Nazis came to power, my mother was coming home from school telling terrible stories of what the little girls were doing to her. She'd come in and find Der Stürmer in her desk. The children would put her on a chair and dance around her singing "When Jewish Blood Spurts from the Sword." Mm-hmm. And suddenly, Herbert, this magnificent playboy, ne'er-do-well, who always spent his father's money and really didn't work very hard, he suddenly found his Zionist heart and he said, "We are not staying here. We are leaving. I am not bringing my children up in this atmosphere." Mm-hmm. And very shortly, he made plans to go. Now, his younger brother, Fritz, who was an ardent communist, he was arrested fairly shortly after the Reichstag fire, and he was taken off to Spandau prison. Mm-hmm. And Herbert said, "I'm out of here." And he wanted to be with other Jews. He could have gone to London. He had contacts there. He could have gone to New York. He'd once done a one-year apprenticeship with a furrier in New York. Mm-hmm. But no, as much as Nelly would have liked to have come to New York mm-hmm. or London, no, he decided, "I'm off. I'm going to the British Mandate of Palestine." And here, very shortly after he arrived, a few months later, Nelly turned up with the three children. And there's a picture of them on the beach. Now, unfortunately, Herbert had managed to take money because they were wealthy. He took money and he promptly lost the lot. He made a bad investment in quite a clever design of refrigerated fronts on shops where people could display meat and milk and cheese and so on, but it went bust. And he had to tell Nelly that money's gone. At which point the marriage started to fall apart fairly quickly. And the bitter end was when Nelly, who had never cooked in her life and was now struggling, cooking on a primus stove in a very grotty little apartment, discovered that Herbert had bought himself a car, if you please, and parked it a few streets away and was using it to go and see his new lady friends. Mm-hmm. So she threw him out. And that was the end of the marriage. And she was left really, really hard up and had to scratch a living somehow. And luckily for her, one of her very rich friends said, "We will educate one of your children in England. Choose which one." And she chose my mother because she was the oldest and she didn't want a 14-year-old around. She felt it aged her and she was rather hoping to get married again. So she didn't want a 14-year-old. And my mother was sent to England at the age of 14 and basically had to bring herself up from then on. And then, of course, the war broke out. She needed a roof over her head. She trained as a nurse. She nursed all through the Blitz at the end of the war. She went to university. She met my father and got married. And that's why I sound... and talking here with an English accent, and all the rest of the family stayed, and eventually they became Israelis, and they're all in Israel.
Mm-hmm. Now, we're about to transition to a different part of the story, so I want to pull back for a moment and address Suzanne and ask her, as a Holocaust historian, can you expand on the seizure of Jewish property and businesses in these early years of the Reich, and what was the timetable and the landscape at that point?
I'm sure most of you in the audience know that Adolf Hitler came to power in January 1933, and within 2 months of that time, already the first anti-Jewish laws were implemented. The boycott that Dina mentions in her book, the expulsion of Jewish civil servants. So it was quite immediate, and in 1933, there were roughly 100,000 Jewish businesses in Germany. By 1937, about 60% had been liquidated or Aryanized, if you will, meaning placed into non-Jewish hands. By that time, by 1937, the total wealth of German Jews had fallen to by 40 or 50%, and one-third of the German Jewish population, like Herbert, had emigrated.
Now, some Jews left Germany soon after Hitler came to power, and what were those families able to leave with, if indeed anything?
Well, there's a very short answer, not much, not much. To return to the case of non-Jewish buyers in the face of trying to take up this property, non-Jewish buyers acquired Jewish property at a fraction of its value. And this was buttressed, and Dina mentions this in her book, by laws that actually preceded the Nazi regime but were used by the Nazis in ways to harass Jewish clients. They would, as happens in the case of Dina's family, calling in the full balance of mortgages, exorbitant tax rates, and other methods to induce Jewish owners to sell their property at criminally low prices. And then for those families that did actually manage to obtain a visa, each family was forced to pay a flight tax of 25% of their overall wealth. And this tax actually generated more than 900 million Reichsmarks for the Nazi regime between 1933 and 1941. And by 1939, what was left after paying this flight tax was essentially confiscated by the Nazi regime under the guise of transferring it to a new currency to wherever that family would emigrate.
So with that historical context that Susanna has just given us, and Dina, thinking about these lavish stories that you were told growing up, can you share with us what caused you to look further into this story? Where did the impetus start?
Well, in 1977, I'm afraid Nellie died. And when she died, she left behind no documents, no photographs, not even an address of this building that she talked to me about that she always dreamt of getting back. And basically, I put it out of my mind. This building that she talked about was behind the Berlin Wall. It was not legally possible to claim on it. So I got on with life, and I became a journalist at the BBC. I got married, had at that point two children. And then in 1989, the Berlin Wall fell. And I thought, I wonder if there's any truth to this. Was she making it up? Could it have been real? Was it a fantasy? And it started to gnaw at me, and I remember watching the footage on television of the Berlin Wall coming down, people streaming into the West, and I turned to my husband and I said, you know, my grandmother used to tell me the amazing stories. Do you think it's true? And he said, well, don't you think have a look and see what you can find out. And after all, I'm second generation, and I really feel the need to know my history. Now, my mother didn't want to go there. She didn't want to look back, but I felt a burning desire to know the truth. I had to get to the bottom of it.
Now, Suzanne, we know that historically speaking, many, but certainly not all, European governments have signed declarations adhering to restitution laws and best practices. Can you tell us, what does the restitution process generally entail?
Not surprisingly, the model for what has become a pattern with different variations across Europe started in West Germany almost immediately after the war. And actually, the case of Germany is an interesting one. By 2000, Germany has paid $100 billion in restitution and compensation claims. We wanted to put this web address up because really there's no one formula from country to country, and we thought that perhaps some in the audience might want to know if they have property in Romania or Lithuania where to turn to. That's why we have this address here. Each country differs, and even within countries, case to case, there are differences. And so it's probably best to start here. But in thinking about what kinds of generalizations one can make, when thinking about what Nazi Germany and her allies stole across all of Europe, think about gold and silver and stocks and bonds and buildings and labor, the portion of the loot taken from European Jews constituted about 10%.
And leading historian Peter Hayes has often commented that in that broader context of the non-Jewish population and the other 90% of looted assets, it's been an uneven road for Jewish families seeking restitution. It's often been an uphill battle. There hasn't been a lot of, often they don't receive a lot of empathy for their losses. And priority has been put, I would say, in every country first on non-Jewish cases.
Mm-hmm. So against this backdrop, which is already an uphill battle, Dina, in terms of your own story, where did you even start? Can you share some of these accounts of you? So you have this history and this wealth of stories. You have this curiosity. Where do you go from there?
Well, where to begin, indeed. I had nothing except these stories. And by chance, well, I was working at the BBC, and there was a researcher who was German. And I told him the story. And I said, if there's any help you can give me, please do. And it didn't take him long to find the first bit of evidence, which was this. Now, this is a 1920 business directory advert for H. Wolff, Berlin, and there is the address, Krausenstrasse 1718. This is similar to the yellow pages here in business advertising. So I had an address, and that was quite exciting. And the luck kept coming. I found an architecture magazine which had photographs of the building at that address. Now, that is the front of the building on the left-hand side, and at the back you can see H. Wolff and a beautiful archway with carvings, six stories high, lovely design. And I found something else. Now, isn't that lovely? Those are H. Wolff fur catalog models, modeling some of the furs that were designed by my great-grandfather, Victor Wolff, and then I suppose his son, Herbert. Now, my mother actually had a very vivid memory of going with her father and grandfather in the chauffeur-driven Mercedes to the building as a little girl, probably five or six, and being taken down into the basement, and she would see the piles of furs there. This she remembered, and she would jump up and down on them, and her father would say, "You can jump on the rabbits, but don't you go jumping on the mink." So that's probably what she was not jumping on, because that doesn't look like rabbit. Yeah. But that certainly it all started to ring true. Mm-hmm.
So then what happens next? How do you have this address, you have a little bit of a visual representation, you have these stories, but where do you go from there?
I thought, well, as every good journalist knows, you have to go there and see it for yourself. Mm-hmm. So that's what I decided to do. I flew to Berlin, and I stayed overnight in a little hotel, and the next day I got in a taxi and I gave the taxi driver the address. And we drove past the wall, we passed Checkpoint Charlie, two blocks on, he stops. And there we are, at the building. And there I am, this is in December 1990, and it was cold, it was really cold, and it was starting to snow, and I've got a woolly hat on and my red duffel coat, and I got somebody to take a photograph of me, and that says that this is the Berlin outpost of the Ministry of Transport. So I'd found it, and there I was, and then I thought, now what? I've got here, do I get in the taxi and go, or do I go in? And I decided I'd go in. I'd come this far, I wasn't going to walk away now. And I asked to speak to the most senior person there. And a rather portly gentleman came down, and he said, "What do you want?" And I said, "I've come to claim my family's building."
Straight away.
And he laughed at me. And he said, "Don't be ridiculous. This building has been owned by the German railways for decades." And I said, "Well, I don't think so." And I pulled out this business directory advert. And he said, "Well, what's this?" And I said, "Well, H. Wolff. He was my grandfather." And he paled, and he said, "Oh, you'd better come in." And he ushered me in through the turnstiles and he took me into the canteen. He said, "You sit here and wait. I'm going to phone head office." And head office then was in Bonn. So I waited about 20 minutes and he came back and he was a changed man. And he said to me, I've just spoken to the head office, and they tell me, you're right. They knew this building was owned by Jews, but they didn't know if anybody had survived. Tell me your story. And I then spent the most incredible 20 minutes, half an hour, telling him the story. At the end of which, he said to me, you need to get this building back for your mother. So at that point, I confessed, actually, I have no proof that I can claim this. I have no legal documents. And he said to me something which was, I think was very brave for an East German official. He said, the documents exist. You need to go out there and find them, but they exist. So start digging. And that's what I did. But I was very, very worried. I thought no documents could possibly have survived. After all, as we know, Berlin was heavily bombed during the war. This is a photograph which shows you the extensive damage that was done by the Allied bombing. Now, at the very bottom of this photo, you can see what looks like a road. That is actually the line of the Berlin Wall. So that's the border. And what is ringed in red, that is the building. And slightly over, basically two blocks, is Checkpoint Charlie. And a little bit up to the north is the Reichstag and the Brandenburg Gate. So you can see it's at central Berlin. Mm-hmm. Hitler's bunker is very close by. I mean, it's obvious why the Allies were bombing there. So I was worried that we would find nothing. But there you are. Sometimes your fears are not well-founded, because I did start to find materials. I went with my husband on a research trip to Berlin, and we desperately needed to prove that the family had owned that building.
Right, owned as opposed to rented.
Exactly.
That makes it
now,
different.
Nellie had all these stories, and she told me about the building, and, oh, this was ours. But it's entirely possible that they had been renting it, and she'd got hold of the wrong end of the stick. So I needed to prove that the family had actually owned it. And in those days, ordinary members of the public could not go to the land registry and get the documents to prove ownership. Only lawyers could do it. And then Simon and I heard that there was an East German lawyer who was acting on behalf of a New York property developer who was interested in getting hold of our building. And we managed to find this man's address. And we got in a taxi and went miles and miles into East Berlin, in the middle of nowhere. And we found his address, and we climbed up loads and loads of stairs to his apartment. We got to the top, and I was completely out of breath. I was pregnant again. And we knocked on the door, and this rather aggressive young man wanted to know what all this was about. So we explained, and he did indeed have the land registry search for this. And he said he could see that this was an opportunity to make money. Here were these people desperate to get hold of it. And so my husband said, well, what do you want? And he said, I want 300 Deutschmarks, which is about $200 at the time. So my husband pulls out his wallet, hands him the money, and we exchange. And we get out of there as fast as possible, jump in the taxi, and we have it. And this is what we had got. This is what our 300 Deutschmarks had bought. You can see the purple stamps. That means it's been notarized. It is the land registry documents charting what has happened to the building. And because it's got these notarized stamps on, it's recognized in a court of law. So we were very excited to have that. And then I'm sitting in the taxi flicking through the pages, and I come to an inside page. Right. Now, you can see here that the building had been owned. It was in the name of Lucy Wolff, and it remained in her name after she died, and it was administered by the lawyer who was acting on behalf of her heirs. And what had happened, quite clearly, was in 1937, the mortgage had been withdrawn, and the building, instead of being put up to auction to the highest bidder, it had been handed over to the Reichsbahn, to Hitler's railways. So that struck us as quite intriguing. And I'm flicking through it, and I get to the final page, and there was something which really was quite astonishing. After the war, the Soviet occupation authorities had gone through that area and charted the former ownership of the buildings, a remarkably honest And what they had written here, this is an addition to the land registry, they had written here, what it means is the Jewish private owner was forced to sell because of the political circumstances of the time. Do not dispose of this property. We were ecstatic.
Yeah, this is really quite astonishing. This is from Soviet authorities acknowledging that there is a Jewish owner.
Yes, isn't it amazing? Yeah. So that was great. So we could prove that the family had owned it. Mm-hmm. Then, of course, if you're going to launch a claim, you have to prove that you are a legal inheritor. And we had to get birth, death, and marriage certificates. Everything to prove that we were who we said we were. Mm-hmm. Interestingly, it wasn't that difficult. The Germans have a penchant for holding onto documents. So we were able to get, but there was one document which seemed to be vital. Now, Nellie had always claimed that she was named in Lucy's will as an inheritor mm-hmm. of this building. And so we needed Lucy's will. Now, given the extensive bombing, we thought, no chance. Lucy had died in 1932. There's Lucy. Actually, she was a lovely lady. I'll tell you a little story about her. My mother had very fond memories of her. And she used to say to my mother, it was a little girl, a lady does not wear jewelry during the day. Only a string of pearls, perhaps. And I'm wearing Lucy's pearls. One of the few things that survived from those days. Well, I persuaded my mother that she should at least try and find Lucy's will. And she phoned Amtsgericht Charlottenburg, which was the local court to Wannsee. And she spoke in her faultless German, and she said to the lady, do you have the will of my grandmother who died in 1932? And the lady said, oh, well, give me the details, I'll go and look. Would you like to hold on, or would you like to phone back? My mum said, oh, I'll phone back. And 10 minutes later, she phoned back. And the lady said, yes, I've got it. Would you like me to mail it to you? And my mother was completely astonished. Mm-hmm. But we had Lucy's will, and Nellie was right. She was named as an inheritor, as was my mother.
So now you really this quite significant cache of documents. But in the midst of all this, you also found something really quite unexpected, and in terms of the link to the Victoria Insurance Company and their part in this story. I'm wondering if you can elaborate on that a bit.
Yes, what had happened, we discovered, was that in 1937, the Victoria Insurance Company, which gave out standard mortgages to many people, many Jewish companies had Victoria Insurance mortgages, and they'd pulled ours in. They just foreclosed on the building. So we started to focus our attention on the Victoria, and my husband Simon went off to the National Archives in Kew, the British National Archives, and he found something which was quite interesting. He found a 1944 document, Who's Who in Nazi Germany, and listed is the chairman of the Victoria Insurance Company. There is his picture. And he is Dr. Kurt Hammann. So the British, this is a confidential War Office document, they had him listed, along with Goebbels and Hitler and all of them. He was known to them. Now, he's quite an interesting fellow, as is the Victoria. During the course of my extensive research, I did discover, frankly, to my horror, that the Victoria had been part of a consortium of insurance companies that had insured Auschwitz. But after the war, in 1953, Dr. Kurt Hammann, who we see here, he was awarded the Federal Cross of Merit, which is Germany's highest civilian honor. And perhaps even more surprising, to this day, he has a foundation in his honor at Mannheim University. So there are hangovers from the past.
Indeed, indeed. So once there's the process of your claim and then there's the actual claim itself, how long did this process take in order for there to have a final decision, and what was the impact of that decision on your family?
Well, the from the point where we put in a claim, which was very early on, I realized, I knew that there was a deadline and you had to register a claim. And I did persuade my mother very early on that at least register a claim. And this was done through a firm of lawyers in London. From that point, it took 6 years to resolve the issue. Of course, in the process, having lodged the claim, I was doing research to stand it up. But it took 6 years, and in the end, what happened is that, and that's the building as it looks today, exactly as it looks today, it became a federal ministry, and the ministry didn't want to move its civil servants out, so they wanted to buy it, and in the end they offered 20 million Deutschmarks. This is in 1996, which was the equivalent then of about $14 million. Mm-hmm. And I was offered, I really want a plaque on this building. This is one of my ambitions. I want a plaque telling the history to anybody who walks past of what happened here. And 2.5 years ago, I was promised by the then Minister of Transport for Germany that a plaque would be put up. We're still waiting. Mm-hmm. Nothing, I'm afraid, has happened there.
Mm-hmm. Now, Suzanne, I imagine that there continue to be hundreds, if not thousands, of individuals with claims to property or funds for their persecuted families during the Holocaust. What resources are available to these individuals who want to seek this kind of restitution?
So I think that Dina's story really tells us that there's a burden of proof. There's a burden of proof usually on the person doing the asking, and one needs documents. And this is going to be true in whatever country one is filing one's claim. And the crucial role that this museum can play is to help seekers get that documentation. Without the documentation, the claims can't go forward. And I know Dina did a lot of work in our fifth floor with our library and archives to help gather some of these materials. The picture here is the International Tracing Service. This is an archive that's only been open since 2007. So it's both the largest and the most recently opened new Holocaust archive in the world. This particular archive has information on the fate of more than 17.5 million people, a quarter of whom are Jewish, roughly, and three quarters of whom are victims from every other nationality you can imagine. I know that Dina used this collection, and I'm sure you'll want to say more about how that was, in order to get crucial documentation like a death certificate or cause of death or documentation of property or the fate of a loved one. So if any of you are looking for to clarify the fate of a loved one or in property matters, I would definitely encourage you to visit the fifth floor, the reference desk, or the second floor, the museum's Holocaust Victims and Survivors Resource Center. And what can seem very daunting will not be so bad. They'll get you started on a good path.
Now, Dina, to that end, we've been talking about the parts of your family that survived, but not the entire family didn't leave Germany, particularly in the early years of Hitler's rise to power. Can you tell us about your great uncle Fritz and what you've since learned?
Yes. This is my mother's uncle Fritz. He's Herbert's brother, the younger son of Victor. And very early on in this process of investigation, I found a transport list that he was on. On March the 1st, he was deported to Auschwitz. This is in 1943. I mean, he was 52 then. I knew he hadn't survived. The family knew that. He had refused to leave Germany. He was a devoted communist. He felt that he was a German beyond anything else. And he fervently believed that this Nazi madness would pass. But I wanted to know rather more. And so I did write to the International Tracing Service to see if they had anything in their records. And indeed they did, surprisingly. Now, this is a document showing that Fritz was taken to Sachsenhausen concentration camp very shortly after Kristallnacht, He was rounded up, and this is these are the papers of him going in. You can see him listed there. It's a correct date of birth, and he's given a number. And accompanying this was the paper, were the papers for 2 weeks later when he was discharged from Saxon. How you can see him listed there with his number. He was. It even shows you that he was in block 61. This is, was quite upsetting. My mother was very, very upset to see this. It's shocking to see lists of people like that with their numbers, and it's very dehumanizing, ghastly. Now, he was let out, and still he refused to leave Germany, and it is quite incredible. We never really knew why he was let out, but my grandfather Herbert said that his theory was that he had got him a visa to go to Syria, and if you promised to leave Germany, then you could get out. And who knows why? He could have left, he had the visa, and he refused, still he refused, and he stayed. And the next document that I found was here in the archives of the Holocaust Museum. I spent a lot of time, as you said, researching, reading around the subject. I would read the Gestapo reports to give me a flavor of the atmosphere of the time. And then I got chatting to one of the archivists, and Megan Lewis, who was very, very helpful. And she said to me, do you know about the census? And I said, no, not really. Well, in May 1939, the Nazis had conducted a census, and they had supplementary forms that if one grandparent was Jewish, of anybody living in the household, the entire household had to fill in a form. She said, let's see if we've got a record of this. And she sat with me at a terminal, and we went through all these digitized photos, and lo and behold, this is what we found. She found it for me. And there is Fritz. And he's living in a Jewish apartment, or with other Jews, and all of them are saying yes, they've all got Jewish grandparents. Mm-hmm. There's a family, the Deutsch family, a mother, father, and a little child. Mm-hmm. I did, in fact, find out what happened to them. It's in the book. It's horrible, really, really terrible. And there is Fritz, and there is somebody else there. There's a man called Joseph Rosner. And you see his date of birth. He was born on January the 12th, 1908. And I then cross-referenced him, trying to find what happened to this man. Well, he's not in any records here. He's not in Yad Vashem. Can't find him anywhere. So I did what I should have done earlier on. I put in his name and his date of birth, put it in Google, and up it came. There is a man with the correct spelling and the correct date of birth who died in January 1971 in Miami, Florida. Incredible. Now, it may not be the same man, but if it is, I'd love to know. I would love to know that that man got out and made it here.
So, Suzanne, Dina's just demonstrated one way of using the rather vast ITS archives to try to find out some of this information. You touched on this a little bit earlier, but I'm wondering if you can elaborate a little bit more about ITS as a resource for those who are seeking restitution. What types of materials are in that archive, and how does that help out people who are really trying to answer this question?
The archive itself is located in a small town called Bad Arolsen, Germany, which was centrally located between the four occupation zones of Germany. And it essentially became a document dump in the 60 years following the war. As the Allies moved through Germany and liberated concentration camp after concentration camp and picked up records that were not destroyed, they gathered these records and sent them to this tiny town in Germany called Bad Arolsen. This set of documents became the basis for a tracing service that operated as a tracing service all the way until 2007. It's still a tracing service, but it's also now an open archive. So in addition to these masses and millions of pages of concentration camp materials that the Allies had captured that show the kind of prisoner information Dina's talking about, in the post-war period, as the Allies were trying to make sense of where victims were buried, make sense of death marches, make sense of what happened in each town across Germany. Allies sent out questionnaires to each village and town in Germany, and the answers to these questionnaires all were deposited in Bad Oelsen. And as the decades went on, many, many inquiries came into Bad Oelsen, some from individuals like Dina's family, from governments who might be looking for collaborators or perpetrators, in addition to victims, from restitution offices trying to establish date of death, cause of death. And these inquiries, too, are now all part of these files that are digitized and available here at the Holocaust Museum and in several other repositories around the world, including Yad Vashem and the Wiener Library in London and several others. Where these documents come into play for governments and for individuals are really to bring this burden of proof that is needed. And we now know how to search them quite effectively. And while one person or one town might seem like a needle in a haystack, we can often find it. And this can be the document that's the difference between receiving a pension or not receiving a pension, for example.
So Dina, in this case, what this really allowed you to do was to paint a full picture of what it was that happened to Fritz in, I think, a really profound way. And as a result of that, you were then able to have a Stolperstein laid at his previous home address the last June. So for those who are not familiar with it, the Stolperstein is a form of memorial in Germany. It's literally a raised brick that stops you in your tracks. And that's the point of it, is to make that very individual. And this was something that you were able to lay for Fritz. And we also have a video of your son Josh at that particular ceremony that I think we'd like to play.
You have been here for the ceremony for Fritz. You are the great-great-nephew of Fritz. We have the year 2015. How does it feel for you?
Well, it's very meaningful for me. My middle name is Frederick, which is the anglicized version of Fritz. I am also born on the 27th of January, which is also the anniversary of the liberation of Auschwitz, which is where Fritz actually died. So it's very meaningful for me. It's a big chapter of my family's history. And so to have just put the Stolpersteine here is another way of remembering Fritz and everything that happened.
Now, Dina, Josh has just articulated what this means to him. I'm wondering if you can speak a little bit to what this meant to the rest of your family and to you to be able to memorialize Fritz in this way.
I was really pleased that I was able to do this. I think it's very important, actually, to remember what happened. And this is an excellent way of doing it. In fact, these stones are now throughout Europe. Mm-hmm. And it was the principle, really. This whole saga has been the principle of doing the right thing. I don't think that we should forget, and I wanted to honor the memory of Nelly, and I wanted to pass on all the knowledge that I could accrue to my children so that they should remember. And I think this was a very meaningful ceremony, actually.
Mm-hmm. Now, we've heard this really quite incredible story of the many, many ways in which you were able to assemble these documents and do all of this very in-depth research. And you were really very fortunate to have your wits about you, to have a wonderful support system, to have the ability to travel when you needed. Would you have pursued the claim to this building if those circumstances had not existed?
Yes. I would, without a doubt. It's in my nature. I would, if there had been an injustice, I had to find it. Mm-hmm. And I don't regret for an instant that I did it. Yes, I was fortunate that I had a tremendous support from my husband, who mm-hmm. always backed me up in this. My mother came round to being quite interested in it once mm-hmm. I got going. And I think I was fortunate in the sense that this was in Germany and I could find documents. I don't know how easy it's going to be for other people mm-hmm. who are trying in the whole of Eastern Europe. And this mm-hmm. is, there is a lot of unfinished business there. Mm-hmm. There are restitution issues that still need to be sorted out. Mm-hmm. And I wish anybody who's trying to do this the best of luck. It's hard work. Mm-hmm.
Well, I want to thank you both so much for being here with us tonight and for sharing your stories. I think what this really does is gives us not only a personal story, but shows us the ways in which documents really tell the story of a family and tell the ways in which lives were torn apart, tell the ways in which people tried to move on, and tell it in this really complex, multifaceted way. So I really want to thank you so much for sharing your story. I want to thank Suzanne so much for providing this really rich context. And I want to close by saying that the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum has one of the world's largest collections of materials and evidence of the Holocaust. But there is still more to be done and still much more to be collected. And before we open up the evening with questions from the audience, which we're really delighted to hear, I'd like to share just a short video with you of some highlights of the importance of the museum's collecting efforts.
This is my mother's letter that she wrote the day that she died in the gas chamber on the 11th of July of 1944, and that she was able to smuggle out of the camp. Eventually it reached my father, who was in a different camp. My mother decided to stay with my brother, who was born with a limp because she knew that he was going to be gassed. My only one and my dearest one, we considered hiding, but we soon dropped that idea because we felt it would have been in vain. The famous trucks are already here and we are waiting for it to begin. Take good care of my golden boy and don't spoil him too much with your love. Have a great life. We must board the trucks. Into eternity, yours, Vilma. It was just devastating when I read it because it brought me so close to her death. That's the note that I've decided to donate to the museum. This is a real note written by a real person, written 2 or 3 hours before she was killed.
We're losing the eyewitness generation, and what we need to do now is capture those stories, get those materials.
All this material is in a state of natural deterioration. If we don't collect it, we lose it.
Each of these artifacts tells a story, and those stories really are the building blocks of what we do as an educational institution.
I am an archivist at the United States Holocaust Memorial Museum. Today we're going to talk about the Michael Krauss collections. Michael Krauss was a teenager during the war. He writes 3 diaries.
So this is the second of 3 notebooks which served as my diary and deals with the stay in Mauthausen. And this illustration shows a prisoner that...
Michael Krauss's diary is an exercise in history, in remembrance. In the future, it could be 100 years from now, 200 years from now, we can claim that something happened, but unless we can prove it, did it really happen? If you don't have evidence to support the memory changes over time, it withers slowly. And in the end, you've just got some sort of legend. You've got some vague ideas or stories of what happened or might have happened. It opens the door to denial. The Holocaust happened. The Holocaust produced a great deal of evidence.
The Holocaust was a worldwide event, and we need to be able to tell that story from every angle, whether it's the victims, the perpetrators, the bystanders. We need to be able to document every aspect of that story from every perspective.
Our museum is active across the globe. We have collected in more than 50 countries. We've been on 6 continents. Our collection will double in size within the next decade. One of the challenges of conserving our collection is that much of it was produced on highly perishable materials. Our conservators really are extremely skilled. The work that they're doing preserves the history of the object, what it went through.
The challenge for us is not only how to preserve it, but how to make it accessible. With such an assault on the truth of the Holocaust, our goal is to digitize everything, put it up on the internet so it's available to anyone, anywhere, anytime.
Our collection belongs to the nation, and in building that collection of record, what we're doing is assuring the relevance of Holocaust memory. What we need to do now is create a state-of-the-art environment. The Chappelle Center is going to be the epicenter of all the work that involves collections, whether it's exhibition, education, scholarship.
We'll have the ability to continue to build the collection, providing the highest level of care under temperature and humidity controls.
What motivated my family to get involved with the Collections and Conservation Center was the opportunity to ensure to actually do something very tangible to enable the memory of the Holocaust to be projected into the future forever. You have to act. You can't just remember. You have to do something.
When the survivors and all the eyewitnesses are gone, this evidence, these collections, will be the sole authentic witness to the Holocaust.
This is the most important building our museum will ever build. Our generation has one moment in time to safeguard truth.
So as you saw, preserving the materials, documents, photos, films, and artifacts are critical, and the museum is working to build the largest Holocaust collection of record. If you would like to learn more about the museum's incredible work to preserve the history, or if you have any collections of your own that you would consider donating to the museum, please speak with one of the staff members here tonight following the program. With the time that we have remaining, I'd like to invite some questions from the audience. We do only have a few minutes, so I will ask you to keep your questions brief. We have a microphone at either side of the podium. Sir. Yeah,
hi. My family has recently recovered a painting from the Gerlitt collection, and we're pursuing other paintings from his from the collection that was owned by my great uncle, as well as thousands of acres that he owned. But my question really goes to something more fundamental, and that is, I'm concerned at this point with this emphasis of Jews recovering property, art, whatever, that we become known as simply more victims who are seeking to recover what was once ours 70 or 75 years ago. And I think to be able to draw the line between victimhood and recovering what is rightfully ours is something that a lot of people really don't know. And finding that line is something that I'm grappling with every day.
Thank you for your comment. You know, we were actually just discussing this a little bit before the program. And it's really not, and I'll let Dina and Suzanne speak to this if they have something to add. It's really not about the stuff. It's really not about the money. It's about the life. This was a life. These were many lives in a whole varying degree of circumstances and in all over Europe and outside of Europe as we're learning more and more that were touched by the war. And that's really what we're talking about here. I don't know if anyone wants to elaborate a bit on that.
You know, I think, sir, that the issue is really justice. One can't have a theft of this monumental level, I mean, absolutely unprecedented theft, and not have the scales rebalanced, even if it takes 70 years, even if it takes 100 years. If those scales are not rebalanced, German society itself can't really recover unless they have an honest reckoning. And this is true across Europe. Unless each country has an honest reckoning of what happened in that country, what was done, returning what belongs rightfully to someone else, there won't be an effective way to move past. And I'm wondering if this is true for the victims' families as well, Dina.
Yeah, I agree with everything you say. I mean, you probably experience meeting people who've gone through what I've gone through or are trying to. I think it's too soon to just forget. I recognize the risk of what you're saying. But what's the alternative?
Going to go to this side of the room.
My question is this. Looking at the screen, it says the name H. Wolff. And if you just had documentation that shows that you're a descendant of H. Wolff, wouldn't that have been just enough to say no?
No.
Why not?
No. You have to stand it up to the... so that it could be tested in a court of law. And you have to prove who this H. Wolff is. In fact, it's not Herbert. It's Victor's father, whose name was Hyman Wolff. And it's named after him, the H. Wolff. So it goes back even further. And the fact that I am a descendant of his, but just because he had his name on the building doesn't mean to say he owned it. I had to prove that he actually owned the bricks and mortar and the land.
So
that was the key.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
I wasn't sure about that.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yes, I was wondering, what about the people who were taken directly to the concentration, the death camps, and were killed immediately? What kind of records are available on them, say their date of death, et cetera, that sort of thing?
I'm going to pop that over to Suzanne, I think.
Sure. There are actually two parts to your question. One is, what records do we have on such victims, and also what happened to their property? In the case of the International Tracing Service, generally for victims who were deported directly to Auschwitz and there murdered by gas, we often have the transport record of arrival in Auschwitz, or at least the departure record from whatever transit camp they might have been in prior to being taken to Auschwitz. So there's not necessarily an Auschwitz-issued death certificate, but there's evidence of their deportation there, and we know how that camp worked. And because this was true of millions of people, there was a lot of unclaimed property, bank accounts that were full, that nobody ever came back to ask about. And the history of what happened to all of this unclaimed property, again, varies country to country. The German case is very interesting, and the Jewish Restitution Successor Organization, the Conference on Jewish Material Claims Against Germany, the histories of many of these bodies are fascinating because they tried to figure out what to do with all this unclaimed property. Most of it, and this is a generalization, most of it has been divided up for survivors and their needs. Some of it has gone to educational endeavors.
Thank you very much. It's almost as if the Nazis kept records because they were proud of what they were doing.
They were. They were proud. They wanted to be good at their jobs, and they wanted to record their successes.
I'm going to go in order. I'm going to go to this gentleman.
What happened to the family home in Wannsee? Yeah.
Great question. Lots of people ask me that. What happened was that parcels of land were sold off to pay the mortgage on Krausenstrasse, and in the end, and I've got the court records where the lawyers were fighting to hold on to this villa in Wannsee, in the end, that was sold in order to pay the mortgage. So the mortgage was being paid, and nevertheless, they foreclosed. Now, after the war, my grandfather did try and get hold of the villa again. He put in a claim, and he didn't succeed, and it can't be reopened. The argument was that it was a fair sale. Personally, I would say I doubt it. Not in 1937, which was when 36, 37, when all these parcels of land were sold off. I can't see how in 1936, 37, that was a fair sale. Would he have got the market rate? I doubt that very much. But it's too late to reopen that case, so it's gone. It still exists. I've been round the house. The house stands. I've been on a tour of it. It was one grand house. Now it's been divided up into apartments, but the people living there were quite interested because I turned up and I was standing on the lawn having my picture taken, and somebody came out and said, "What are you doing?" So I explained, "My mother used to live here." So they said, "Oh, come in, have a look around."
This will be our last question for the evening.
Thank you very much, and thanks for sharing your wonderful story. One of the things that I was thinking about, Suzanne mentioned how different nations are struggling with their pasts in different ways. Is there any effort to work on guidelines, taking the best practices from different countries, how they deal with the past, how they deal with reparations, how they teach about it to their students in their nation?
One for you,
Suzanne. I think I'm gonna go out on a limb. I recall reading that within the last 10 years, there was an attempt to write a best practices guide. I think, and Dina and I discussed this, that really the best approach is to go country by country, and within that country, case by case. It depends so much, and your story shows this, on who you encounter on the other side of the desk. You might have somebody very helpful, like Dina had when she first went into the Wolff building. You might have someone not so helpful.
Do you hope that from writing the book, people and nations will learn how to better deal with this?
I would very much hope so. but I'm not holding my breath.
Thank you very much.
On that somewhat optimistic, pessimistic note, we will end the evening. I want to extend my thanks to Dina for her generosity and for sharing her story. I want to extend my thanks to Suzanne for providing this really rich context, as well as to the many other staff members here at the museum who have been involved in this program. I would like to invite you all to a book signing following the program with Dina, who will be signing copies of her book, and with Suzanne, who will be signing copies of her book as well. And I thank you all so much for coming this evening.